Hello friends, welcome back to a new lecture. Friends, this is one of the most important lectures for any banker. Ratio analysis is one topic which is not only important for JIB, CIB and bank promotions, but also for day-to-day credit analysis. This is in fact one topic that won't leave you till you are in the banking sector. So let's first see its importance in JIB and CIB. So in JIB, this appears in Paper B, that is Accounting and Finance for Bankers, in Module B under Final Accounts. While in CIB, Ratio Analysis forms an important part in Paper 1, that is Advanced Bank Management under Credit Management Module, that is here. So friends, you can see how important Ratio Analysis is. But the irony is, most students find this topic most difficult. So, if you are a JIB candidate, this lecture becomes even more important. So, if you clear this topic now, then this makes your CIB paper 1, that is Advanced Bank Management, bit easy, as many questions are asked from ratio analysis. So, let's start. First, let us see the agenda of this lecture, that is what this lecture covers and what you will learn by the time you finish off this lecture. Friends, we will start by learning some ratio analysis basics. Then we will learn the advantages of ratio analysis. After this, we will learn the significance of ratio analysis. That is, what's the need for learning ratio analysis and why it's even more important for you to learn ratio analysis being a banker. Then we will see some categories of ratios. Then we will look at format of balance sheet for ratio analysis. Now friends, this topic has been added to this lecture as many bankers are from science or arts background and often face difficulty in understanding where to put different heads of the balance sheet, that is classifying them as assets and liabilities. Most often in exams, you will be given a balance sheet or a data from the balance sheet and you will be asked to calculate some ratios from that. Now, when you don't even know whether the heading belongs to asset or liability, then friends, it's very difficult for you to find those ratios. So this topic is very important for such students. Next, we will see a checklist which you must know to start with ratio analysis. This will cover important points which will make your task of understanding ratio analysis bit easy. Finally, we will start with the type of ratios, that is liquidity ratios. Friends, though my advice is that you should not miss any part of this lecture, but if you are from commerce background or MBA, then you can directly start from this topic, that is liquidity ratios. Next, we will learn turnover ratios. Then we will look at solvency ratios. And lastly, we will see profitability ratios. Friends, this lecture is not just theory because you can't make any concept clear if you don't solve questions. So this lecture is full of questions at every step to make your hurdle to understand this important topic faster. And friends, in exam also, you will face similar questions as we solve during this lecture. So don't miss any question. Finally, friends, do watch this lecture till end as I have a free surprise bonus for all of you. So do stick till end of this lecture. Friends, if you have joined this amazing channel for the first time, then we offer free 30-day Excel planners for both JIB and CIB. These Excel planners will help you in your JIB and CIB preparations and you can manage your syllabus as well as time very efficiently. Not only this, these planners help you in marking what has been left so that you don't miss any part of the syllabus before the exams. The links to all the planners are in the description to this video, so do check out when you finish this lecture. So friends, let's start with the lecture. Let us first see what ratio analysis is. Friends, ratio analysis refers to the systematic use of ratios to interpret the financial statements, that is, balance sheets, profit and loss statements, and cash flow statements in terms of the operating performance and financial position of any firm. Ratio analysis not only tells the performance of any firm during a period, but it also helps to find out any cross-sectional or time series relation between various ratios. Friends, in the past, security was considered to be sufficient consideration for bank and financial institutions to grant loans and advances. But nowadays, the entire lending is need-based, and thus the emphasis is mainly on the financial viability of a proposal and not only on security alone. Moreover, almost all business decisions contains an element of risk. The risk is in fact more in case of decisions relating to credits. The fact is, ratio analysis and other quantitative techniques helps us in assessing the risk. So friends, we can say that ratio analysis is the process of computing, determining and presenting the relationship of related items and group of items of a financial statements. Ratio analysis in fact provides the financial position of any firm in a summarized and concise form. Friends, I most often use an Excel template to analyze the performance of any firm. This is the screenshot of my Excel template. Here I am analyzing Asian Paints, which is one of a leading paint manufacturer of India. Now please see these red cells. Now this shows the financial troubles of this firm, and these green cells show the stability of the firm. I calculate all these ratios and then analyze the stability of the firm over the years. Friends, before moving ahead with our lecture, if you have missed our 1000 series of question banks for GIB, then do check these question banks now. These contains 1000 questions in each question bank and are full of case studies. We have also added detailed explanations to the questions in the accounting book also, so that non-commerce students don't face any problem, since they found accounting most challenging paper in GIB. Friends, my personal advice would be to go for the combo pack, as we are currently giving new module E, that is Ethics Notes plus Question Bank, complimentary with this. Not only this, we are also giving cheat sheet of legal along with this combo pack. So the fact of matter is, this is true value for money. So you can check the description of this video to avail this offer. Now let's move ahead with our lecture. So friends, we already saw why ratio analysis is required. Let's see some more advantages of ratio analysis. Some of the advantages of ratio analysis are, first is forecasting and planning. Friends, the trend in cost, sales, profits and other facts can be known only by computing ratios of relevant accounting figures of the last few years. This trend analysis with the help of ratios may be useful for forecasting and planning future business activities. This you already saw in the last slide, where I analyzed Asian Paints over the years to analyze various ratios. The second advantage is budgeting. Now friends, budget is an estimate of future activities from experience, and accounting ratios helps us to estimate budgeted figures. For example, estimated sales may be predicted with the help of analysis of past sales increment percentages. Next is measurement of operating efficiency. Now friends, ratio analysis indicates the degree of efficiency in the management and utilization of its assets. Different activity ratios indicate the operational efficiency. In fact, the solvency of any firm depends upon the sales revenues generated by utilizing its assets efficiently. Next advantage is communication. Friends, ratios are effective means of communication and play a vital role in informing the position and progress made by the business concerned to the owners or other parties. Now, as you saw in the analysis of Asian Paints in the last slide, Asian Paints made a steady increase in gross profit, which indicates healthy sign of the firm. Next is control of performance and cost. Now friends, ratios may also be used for control of performances of the different divisions or departments of a firm, as well as control of cost. That is, if the expenses of the firm are increasing year on year, then this may be an alarming sign for the firm. Friends, you can also notice when the auditor in your branch comes for inspection and sees your branch balance sheet. Now if he notices a sudden increase in expenses of your branch, then he makes a bold comment in his report, and BM has to reply for that to the top management. Now when I was a BM of a branch and suddenly the postage had made a sudden increase from the previous year, then auditor made a comment, but I replied the genuine reason. And the reason was, I started sending thank you letters to the customers, which was not the practice previously. Next advantage is inter-firm comparison. Friends, comparison of performance of two or more firms reveals the difference between efficient and inefficient firms, thereby enabling inefficient firms to adopt some measures for improving their efficiency. In fact, the best way of inter-firm comparison is to compare the relevant ratios of the organization with the average ratios of the industry. Next advantage is indication of liquidity position. Friends, ratio analysis helps to assess the liquidity position, that is short-term debt paying ability of a firm. Liquidity ratios indicate the ability of a firm to pay and help in credit analysis of the banks, creditors, and other suppliers of the short-term loans. Next advantage is indication of long-term solvency position. Friends, ratio analysis is also used to assess the long-term debt-paying capacity of a firm. Long-term solvency position of a borrower is a prime concern to the long-term creditors, security analysts, and the present and potential owners of the business. It is in fact measured by the leverage or capital structure and profitability ratios, which indicate the earning power and operating efficiency. Ratio analysis thus shows the strength and weakness of a firm in this respect. Next is indication of overall profitability. Friends, the management is always concerned with the overall profitability of the firm. They want to know whether the firm can meet its short-term as well as long-term obligations to its creditors or not. Now, this is possible if all the ratios are considered together. Next is signal of corporate sickness. Friends, a company is sick when it fails to generate profit on a continuous basis and suffers a severe liquidity crisis. So in this case, proper ratio analysis can give a signal of corporate sickness in advance so that timely measures can be taken to prevent the occurrence of such sickness. Friends, you will learn a concept called Altman Z-score in Bank Financial Management paper of CIB, which is nothing but the use of ratio analysis only to check the future state of any company. Next, we have aid to decision making. Friends, ratio analysis helps to take decisions like whether to supply goods on credit to a firm or whether bank loans will be made available and any such important decisions in day-to-day working of any firm. Lastly, we have simplification of financial statements. Friends, ratio analysis makes it easy to grasp the relation between various items and helps in understanding the financial statements. Now friends, if you are CIB candidate, then you can check our 1000 series of question banks for both advanced bank management and bank financial management paper. Both these question banks contains 1000 questions. Now speciality of these question banks is that these are full of case studies, which is latest trend of CIB. Moreover, these question banks contains detailed explanations. Now this makes your learning even more easy. And this is also beneficial for the bankers who have not yet finished their theory books. So friends, do check out description of this video for more details. Now friends, single ratio in itself is not very meaningful. There are basically three kinds of comparisons which we do using ratio analysis. The first is obviously intra-company. So for example, if Bank of India's growth in profit in the year 2019 is 10% from the previous year, then we can simply say that the bank made a healthy growth year on year. But this solo comparison can't tell you whether the bank made good growth or it's just an average growth. So for this, the analysis needs to be done intercompany. For example, if SBI made a growth of 9% in the year 2019 and PNB made a growth of 11% in the same year, then we can say PNB did much better than SBI. But friends, this comparison also doesn't make much sense when there are many other banks in the industry. So lastly, we have industry-wise comparison. In this, we compare the ratio of a firm, say XYZ Limited, to the industry average. And that tells us whether the company really made good growth or not. So in this example, if XYZ Limited made a growth of 9%, but industry's average growth is 11%, then we can say that XYZ Limited didn't make good growth as compared to the industry in which it belongs. So friends, hope you got the point. So friends, ratio analysis not only compares different ratios within a company year on year, but also the comparison is made with other company and with other companies of the industry. Now let's move ahead and see types of ratios. Friends, basically ratios are divided into four broad categories. The first is liquidity ratios. Friends, to meet day-to-day operations, a business needs liquid funds. Now, for those who don't understand what liquidity is, Liquidity is basically the ability of the business to pay the amount due to stakeholders as and when it is due. And the ratios calculated to measure it are simply known as liquidity ratios. Next set of ratios is turnover ratio. This refers to the ratios that are calculated for measuring the efficiency of the operations of business based on the effective utilization of the resources. Hence, these are also known as efficiency ratios. Then we have solvency ratios. Friends, solvency ratios throw light on the long-term solvency of a firm. Now, solvency is basically the ability of a company to meet its long-term debts and financial obligations. Solvency is in fact very essential for staying in business as it demonstrates a company's ability to continue operations into the future. And the last set of ratios is profitability ratios. These ratios helps in analysis of profits about revenue from operations or funds employed in the business. So friends, these are the four broad categories of the ratios. So before we start learning with all these four types of ratios, let us understand the format of balance sheet with respect to ratio analysis. Since I receive countless queries that students are most often confused in placing different heads under assets or liabilities, and frankly friends, if one can't classify any head given in the question under asset or liability, then it's really hard to solve any question of ratio analysis. So please pause the video and note down this important table somewhere, and you will never get confused in placing different heads under assets or liabilities. Now let's see an important checklist with respect to ratio analysis. Note down all the points very carefully, as these will make your task of solving questions in ratio analysis pretty easy. So first note that liabilities have credit balance and assets have debit balance. Then the current liabilities are those who have either become due for the payment or shall fall due for the payment within 12 months from the date of the balance sheet. Similarly, the current assets are those which undergo a change in their shape or form within 12 months. These are also called working capital or gross working capital. Also note that net worth and long-term liabilities are also called long-term sources of the fund. Similarly, the current liabilities are also known as short-term sources of the fund. Also note that long-term liabilities and short-term liabilities are also called outside liabilities. Another point to note is, the current assets are short-term use of the funds and assets other than current assets are long-term use of the funds. Also note that the installments of term loan payable in 12 months are to be taken as current liability only for calculation of current ratio and quick ratio, which we will discuss later in this lecture. Next point to remember is, if there is a profit, it shall become part of net worth under the head reserves, and if there is a loss, it will become part of intangible assets. Lastly, investment in government securities are to be treated current only if these are marketable and due, while the investment in other securities must be treated current only if they are quoted. Friends, do remember these points, as these will make your task pretty easy. So with basics cleared, let's move ahead with our lecture and start with the first category of the ratios, that is liquidity ratios. Now friends, this ratio measures the ability of the firm to meet its short-term obligations, that is the capacity of the firm to pay its current liabilities as and when they are due. Thus, these ratios reflect the short-term financial solvency of a firm. Friends, a firm should ensure that it does not suffer from lack of liquidity at any point in its operation. If there is failure to meet obligations on due time, then this may result in bad credit image, loss of creditors' confidence, and even leads to legal proceeds against the firm. So it is necessary to maintain a proper balance between liquidity and lack of liquidity. Now let's see type of liquidity ratios. There are mainly three types of liquidity ratios that explain the liquidity of a firm. First is current ratio. Second is asset test ratio or quick ratio. Then lastly, third is absolute liquid ratio or cash ratio. Friends, please note that there are many names for different ratios. I will also give you alternate names for the ratios so that you don't confuse in the exam if you see any other name other than the name you see normally in your books. So let's first learn what a current ratio is. Friends, current ratio establishes a relationship between current assets and current liabilities. The main objective for computing this ratio is to measure the ability of the firm to meet its short-term obligations and to reflect the short-term financial strength or solvency of a firm. Or we can say the objective is to measure the safety margin available for short-term creditors. It is simply calculated as current assets divided by current liabilities. Now, current assets include assets like inventories of raw materials, finished goods, work in progress, stores and spares, and loose tools. Then we have sundry debtors. Then thirdly, short-term loan deposit and advances. Then cash on hand and bank. Then prepaid expenses and accrued income. Then bills receivables. And lastly, marketable investment or short-term securities. Now, current liabilities includes sundry creditors, bills payables, outstanding expenses, unclaimed dividends, interest accrued but not due on secured and unsecured loans, then advances received, then income received in advance, then provision for tax, then proposed dividend, loan installment of secured and unsecured loans payable within 12 months. Let's see what's the significance of current ratio. Now, as we learned earlier, the current ratio indicates the amount of current assets available for repayment of current liabilities. The ideal current ratio acceptable in India for a company is 2:1. If this ratio is too high, then this might suggest that too much of assets are tied up to the unproductive activities. And if you find this ratio too low, then that means there is risk of not being able to pay your debts on time. Now, let's solve a practical example to make the concept of current ratio more clear. The following information is given about a firm and you have to find the current ratio. So, as we learned earlier, the current ratio is calculated as current assets divided by current liabilities. Now, your first task is to find current assets from the table given. So, current assets will be sum of inventories plus trade receivables plus advance tax plus cash and cash equivalents, which is rupees 50,000 plus 50,000 plus 4,000 plus 30,000. That comes out to be rupees 1,34,000. Now we have to find current liabilities from the given table. From the table, the current liabilities are trade payables plus short-term borrowings, which is rupees 1 lakh plus rupees 4,000. This adds to rupees 1,04,000. So current ratio will be 1,34,000 divided by 1,04,000, that is 1.29:1. Friends, hope the question is clear to you. Let's now see the second ratio from the category of liquidity ratios. This ratio is also known as quick ratio or liquidity ratio. Now friends, asset test ratio basically establishes a relationship between quick assets and current liabilities. The primary objective of computing this ratio is to measure the ability of the firm to meet its short-term obligations as and when due without relying upon realization of stock. Asset test ratio is simply calculated as quick assets divided by current liabilities. Now, quick assets are those current assets which can be converted into cash immediately or at short notice without a loss of value. Now, quick assets include cash balances or bank balances, marketable securities, debtors, then bills receivable, and lastly, short-term loans and advances. Now, as we learned earlier, the significance of quick ratio is to measure the instant debt-paying capacity of the business enterprise. Let's solve a practical example to understand this ratio. Now, the following data is given and you have to calculate the liquidity ratio. Now, friends, as you learned in the previous slide, liquidity ratio is calculated simply as quick assets divided by current liabilities. Your only task is to identify quick assets and current assets from the data given. Friends, quick assets can be calculated as the current assets and subtracting inventories, prepaid expenses, and advance tax from this. So 80,000 minus rupees 20,000 plus 5,000 plus 5,000, which gives rupees 50,000. Now current assets are already given in the data as rupees 50,000. Finally, liquidity ratio will be rupees 50,000 divided by rupees 50,000, that is 1:1. Friends, hope you got the question and how we got the figures from the data given. Now, the third ratio in the category of liquidity ratio is absolute liquid ratio, which is also known as cash ratio. Friends, this ratio shows the relationship between absolute liquid or super quick current assets and liabilities. Now, absolute liquid assets include cash, bank balances, and marketable securities. This ratio is calculated simply by dividing absolute liquid assets with current liabilities. Friends, ideally this ratio is 1:2, and if the ratio is less than the standard of 1:2, it means the concern is not liquid. Friends, with this we finish liquidity ratios. Now let's see a practical example which covers all the liquidity ratios. So from this balance sheet, calculate the current ratio, asset test ratio and absolute liquid ratio. And lastly, also comment on all these ratios. Let us first calculate current ratio. Now, as we learned earlier, the current ratio equals current assets divided by current liabilities. Now, our first task is to find out current assets and current liabilities from the balance sheet. Now, current assets are bills receivable plus bank balance plus short-term investments plus prepaid expenses plus stock. So current assets equals ₹70,000 plus ₹45,000 plus ₹25,000 plus ₹5,000 plus ₹30,000, which gives ₹2,65,000. Now current liabilities are bills payable plus sundry creditors plus bank overdraft plus outstanding expenses. So current liabilities will be ₹60,000 plus ₹70,000 plus ₹30,000 plus ₹5,000, which gives ₹1,65,000. Now the current ratio will be current assets divided by current liabilities, which is ₹2,65,000 divided by ₹1,65,000, which gives 1.61. Let's now find asset test ratio. Now, as we learned earlier, asset test ratio equals liquid assets divided by current liabilities. So, liquid assets from the balance sheet are the current assets, and we will subtract stocks and prepaid expenses from this, which gives ₹2,30,000. And the current liabilities we already found while calculating current ratio, that is ₹1,65,000. So, asset test ratio will be ₹2,30,000. Divided by ₹1,65,000, that is 1.39. Now let us see how to calculate absolute liquid ratio. Absolute liquid ratio is absolute liquid assets divided by current liabilities. Now absolute liquid assets from the balance sheet are bank balance plus short-term investments, which gives ₹45,000 plus ₹25,000, that is ₹70,000. Finally, absolute liquid ratio will be 70,000 divided by 1,65,000, that is 0.42. Lastly, friends, we also have to make our comments on all these ratios. So first is current ratio. Now the current ratio of the company is not satisfactory because the ratio 1.61 is below the general accepted standard of 2:1. While asset test ratio on the other hand is more than the normal 1:1. Friends, liquid assets are in fact quite sufficient to provide a cover to the current liabilities. Lastly, the absolute liquid ratio is 0.42, which is slightly less than the accepted standard of 0.5. Friends, let us now move on to the next category of the ratios, that is turnover ratios. Friends, turnover ratios are also called activity ratios or efficiency ratios. With these ratios, a firm manages its current assets. Now, turnover ratios mainly measure the efficiency of a firm or a company in generating revenues by converting its product into cash or sales. These ratios indicate the speed at which activities of a business are being performed. The activity ratios express the number of times assets employed or any part of the assets is turned into sales during an accounting period. Also note that higher turnover ratio means better utilization of assets and signifies improved efficiency and profitability. And friends, because of this reason only, they are also known as efficiency ratios. Now, there are primarily four types of turnover ratios. First is inventory turnover ratio. Second is debtor turnover ratio. Then third is creditor turnover ratio. And fourth one is assets turnover ratio. Let us see each one of these in detail. So first is inventory turnover ratio. Friends, this ratio primarily establishes a relationship between cost of goods sold and average inventory. This ratio indicates the number of times the inventory has been converted into sales during a particular period. Thus, it evaluates the efficiency of a firm in managing its inventory. Now, inventory turnover ratio is calculated as cost of goods sold divided by average inventory. Now, cost of goods sold is simply opening inventory plus net purchases plus direct expenses minus closing inventory. Or it can also be found as net sales minus gross profit. Then average inventory is simply opening inventory plus closing inventory divided by 2. Now friends, a higher ratio indicates efficient performance. So an improvement in this ratio shows that either the same volume of the sales have been maintained with the lower investment in stocks, or the volume of sales has increased without any increase in the amount of stocks. But friends, a too high ratio may be the result of very low inventory levels, which may result in frequent stockouts, and thus the firm may suffer from high stockout cost. Lastly, a too low ratio may be the result of excessive inventory levels. Thus, a firm should neither have a very high nor a very low turnover ratio. It should have a satisfactory level. Now, to judge whether the ratio is satisfactory or not, it should be compared with its own past ratios or with ratios of similar firms in the same industry. Or you can also compare with industry average. Let us now see a practical example of inventory turnover ratio. From the following information, calculate the inventory turnover ratio. And the information given is this. Friends, we already learned that inventory turnover ratio equals cost of goods sold, or we can also say cost of revenue from operations divided by average inventory. Now COGS equals inventory in the beginning plus net purchases plus wages plus carriage inward minus inventory at the end, which equals rupees 18,000 plus rupees 46,000 plus rupees 14,000 plus rupees 4,000 minus rupees 22,000, which equals rupees 60,000. Now our second step would be to calculate average inventory. So average inventory would be inventory in the beginning plus inventory at the end divided by 2. That is rupees 18,000 plus rupees 22,000 divided by 2, which gives rupees 20,000. Therefore, the inventory turnover ratio will be rupees 60,000 divided by rupees 20,000, that is 3 times. Friends, hope the question is clear to you. Now let's move on to the second type of turnover ratio, that is debtor turnover ratio. This is also called debtor's velocity. Friends, debtors form an important part of current assets, and therefore the quality of debtors greatly determines a firm's liquidity. Main purpose of this ratio is to measure the liquidity of the receivables or to find out the period over which the receivables remain uncollected. So we can say the objective of this ratio is to find number of times average debtors have been converted into cash during a year. This ratio is determined simply by dividing net credit sales by average debtors. Now, net credit sales consist of gross credit sales minus sales returns, while trade debtors include sundry debtors and bills receivables. Average trade debtors is simply opening plus closing balances divided by 2. Friends, debtors turnover ratio is an indication of speed with which a company collects its debts. The higher the ratio, the better it is, because it indicates that debts are being collected quickly. A low ratio, on the other hand, indicates a longer collection period, which implies delayed payments for debtors. Let us now solve a practical example to make the concept of debtors turnover ratio more clear. In this question, calculate the debtors turnover ratio from the following figures. Now, total sale for the year 2018 is rupees 1 lakh. Then cash sales for the year 2018 is rupees 20,000. Then debtors as on 1st January 2018 is 10,000. Then debtors as on 31st December 2018 is 15,000. Then bills receivables as on 1st January 2018 is 7,500. Lastly, bills receivables as on 31st December 2018 is 12,500. So friends, our first task is to find net credit sales. Now note that total sales is rupees 1 lakh, out of which 20,000 is cash sales. So net credit sales would be 80,000. Now let's move on to the second task. That is to find average accounts receivables. Friends, as we learned in the last slide, trade debtors includes sundry debtors and bills receivables. So opening trade debtors will be rupees 10,000 plus 7,500, that is 17,500. While closing trade debtors will be 15,000 plus 12,500, that is 27,500. So average trade debtors will be half of rupees 17,500 plus rupees 27,500, that is 22,500. Finally, debtors turnover ratio will be credit sales divided by average account receivables. That is rupees 80,000 divided by rupees 22,500, that is 3.56 times. Friends, I hope the question is clear. If you face any problem, then kindly ask your queries in comments. Let's move on to the third type of turnover ratio, that is creditors turnover ratio, which is also called creditors velocity. This ratio indicates the number of times sundry creditors have been paid during a year. It is mainly calculated to judge the requirements of cash for paying sundry creditors. Now, to calculate creditors' velocity, just divide the net credit purchases by average creditors. Now, average trade payables will be opening creditors plus opening bills payable plus closing creditors plus closing bills payables divided by 2. Friends, net credit purchases mainly consist of gross credit purchases minus purchase returns. This ratio helps in judging the efficiency in getting the benefits of credit purchases offered by suppliers of the goods. Thus, this ratio helps in finding out the exact time that a firm is likely to take in repaying to its trade payables. Also note, a high ratio indicates the shorter payment period, while a low ratio indicates a longer payment period. Friends, let us again solve a practical example to understand the concept better. From the following figures, calculate the creditors turnover ratio, and the information given is the credit purchases during 2018 equals 1 lakh, then bills payable as on January 1st 2018 is 4000, then creditors as on 1st January 2018 is 20,000, then bills payable on 31st December 2018 equals 6000. Lastly, creditors on 31st December 2018 is 10,000. Now friends, we have already learned in the last slide that to calculate creditors' velocity, we have to just divide the net credit purchases by average trade creditors. So net purchases will be rupees 1 lakh as given in the data. Now average trade creditors will be calculated as opening creditors plus opening bills payable plus closing creditors plus closing bills payables divided by 2. That will be 4000 plus 20,000 plus 6000 plus 10,000 divided by 2. On solving this, you will get 20,000. Thus, creditors' turnover ratio will be simply the credit purchases, that is rupees 1 lakh, divided by average accounts payable, that is rupees 20,000, which gives 5 times. Friends, hope this question is also clear to you. Let us move on to the last type of turnover ratio, that is asset turnover ratio. Now this ratio is again divided into 5 types, that is total asset turnover ratio, second is net asset turnover ratio, then third is fixed asset turnover ratio, then fourth is the current asset turnover ratio, and lastly we have net working capital turnover ratio. Let's understand each one of these in detail. So first is total asset turnover ratio. Friends, this ratio shows the firm's ability to generate from all the financial resources committed to the total asset. It is calculated simply by dividing sales by total assets. Next is net asset turnover ratio. This is also called capital employed turnover ratio. This is calculated simply by dividing sales by net assets. Friends, please note that net asset represents total assets minus current liabilities. Also remember, intangible and fictitious assets like goodwill, patents, accumulated losses, the deferred revenue expenses may be excluded for calculating the net asset turnover ratio. Next is fixed asset turnover ratio. Now this is an important ratio and many questions over the years have been asked from this. Friends, fixed asset turnover ratio establishes a relationship between net sales and fixed assets. The main objective of computing this ratio is to determine the efficiency with which the fixed assets are utilized. This ratio is simply calculated by dividing net sales by net fixed assets. Here, net sales means gross sales minus sales returns, while net fixed assets simply means gross fixed assets minus depreciation. This ratio indicates the firm's ability to generate sales per rupee of investment in fixed assets. In other words, higher the ratio, the more efficient the management and utilization of fixed assets and vice versa. So compared with the previous period, it indicates whether the investment in fixed assets have been judicious or not. Let's solve a practical example to understand the topic clearly. From the data given, calculate fixed assets turnover ratio. Friends, we already learned in the last slide that fixed asset turnover ratio is simply calculated by dividing net sales by net fixed assets. Now, net sales equals cash sales plus credit sales minus sales returns. So that means 1,50,000 plus 17 lakhs minus 50,000, which gives rupees 18 lakh. Let us now calculate net fixed assets. So it will be fixed assets minus depreciation. That is rupees 7 lakh minus 1 lakh, which gives rupees 6 lakhs. Finally, fixed asset turnover ratio equals net sales, that is rupees 18 lakhs, divided by net fixed assets, that is rupees 6 lakhs. So this gives 3 times. Let us move ahead with our lecture. Now let's understand last type of asset turnover ratio, which is net working capital turnover ratio. Friends, working capital of a concern is directly related to revenue from operations, that is sales. The current assets like debtors, bill receivables, cash, stock, etc. can change with the increase or decrease in revenue from operations. This ratio, in fact, establishes a relationship between net sales and working capital. The working capital turnover ratio indicates the speed at which the working capital is utilized for business operations. It is simply calculated by dividing sales by working capital. Here the sales are net sales, which means gross sales minus sales returns, while working capital is represented by difference between current assets and current liabilities. Friends, this ratio indicates the firm's ability to generate sales per rupee of working capital. It is the velocity of working capital ratio that indicates the number of times the working capital is turned over in a course of a year. So a high ratio indicates efficient utilization of working capital and a low ratio indicates working capital is not properly utilized. Let's see a practical example to calculate the working capital turnover ratio. Now friends, from the following data, calculate working capital turnover ratio. Now as we learned earlier, working capital turnover ratio is calculated by dividing net sales by working capital. Now let's find out both these figures first. Friends, net sales will be simply cash sales plus credit sales minus sales return. So that is 2,60,000 plus 12 lakh minus 20,000, which gives 14,40,000. Then working capital will be the current assets minus current liabilities. That is rupees 6 lakh minus 1,20,000. That is 4,80,000. Finally, working capital turnover ratio will be net sales, that is 14,40,000, divided by working capital, that is 4,80,000, that is approximately 3 times. Friends, hope this example is also clear to you. Friends, now we will see the third category of the ratios, that is solvency ratios. These are also called leverage ratios. Now the term solvency refers to the ability of a business concern to meet its long-term obligations. The long-term liability of a firm is basically towards debenture holders, financial institutions providing medium and long-term loans, and other creditors selling goods on credit. These ratios indicate the firm's ability to meet the fixed interest and its cost and repayment schedules associated with its long-term borrowings. Friends, in other words, solvency ratios, which are also known as long-term solvency ratios, measures the ability of a business to survive for a long period of time. These ratios are in fact very important for stockholders and creditors. Friends, solvency ratios are normally used to, first is to analyze the capital structure of the company, then secondly, to evaluate the ability of the company to pay interest on long-term borrowings, then to evaluate the ability of the company to repay the principal amount of the long-term loans, and lastly, to evaluate whether the internal qualities, that is stockholders' funds, and external equities, that is creditors' funds, are in right proportion. Now friends, various solvency ratios used are, first is debt to equity ratio, then second is debt to capital employed ratio, then third is proprietary or equity ratio, fourth one is fixed asset to net worth ratio, fifth is fixed asset to long term funds ratio, and lastly we have debt service or interest coverage ratio. So let's start with learning all the solvency ratios one by one. So first is debt to equity ratio. Now debt to equity ratio shows the relative claims of the creditors, that is outsiders, and the owners against the assets of the firm. Thus, this ratio indicates the relative proportions of debt and equity in financing the firm's assets. It can be calculated by dividing outsiders' fund, that is debt, by shareholders' fund, that is equity. Friends, the outsider funds mainly includes long-term debts as well as current liabilities. The shareholder funds includes equity share capital, preference share capital, reserves and surplus, including accumulated profits. Now please note that the shareholder funds so calculated are also known as net worth of the business. Friends, debt to equity ratio measures the degree of the debt of an enterprise and gives an idea to the long-term lender regarding the extent of security of the debt. Also note that in India, this ratio may be taken as acceptable if it is 2:1. If the debt to equity ratio is more than that, it shows a rather risky financial position from the long-term point of view. Then a ratio of 1, that is 1:1, means that creditors and stockholders equally contribute to the assets of the business. Also note that a less than 1 ratio indicates that the portion of the assets provided by stockholders is greater than the portion of assets provided by creditors. And a greater than 1 ratio indicates that the portion of assets provided by creditors is greater than the portion of assets provided by stockholders. Thus, we can say a low debt to equity ratio reflects more security, while a high ratio, on the other hand, is considered risky as it may put the firm into difficulty in meeting its obligations to outsiders. Let us solve a question so that the concept of debt to equity is more clear. And the question is, from the following data, calculate the debt to equity ratio. Now friends, we already learned that debt to equity ratio is calculated by dividing outsiders' fund, that is debt, with shareholders' fund, that is equity. So our first target is to find both these values from the data given. Let's first calculate shareholders' fund. Now shareholders' fund will be equity share capital plus reserves plus accumulated profits. This will be 1 lakh plus 45,000 plus 30,000. This gives 1,75,000. Now total debts will be debentures plus sundry creditors, which is a current liability, plus outstanding expenses, which is also a current liability. So total debt will be 75,000 plus 40,000 plus 10,000, which gives rupees 1,25,000. So debt to equity ratio will be 1,25,000 divided by 1,75,000, which gives 0.714. Let's move on to second type of solvency ratio, that is debt to capital employed ratio. Now friends, this ratio is a variation of debt to equity ratio only and gives similar indications as that of debt to equity ratio. In this ratio, the outside long-term liabilities are related to the total capitalization of the firm and not merely to the shareholders' fund. This ratio is simply computed by dividing the long-term debt by capital employed. Now friends, the interpretation of this ratio is that this ratio shows the proportion of long-term debts in capital employed. A low ratio provides security to the lenders, while a high ratio is not suitable. Let's move on to the third type of solvency ratio, that is proprietary or equity ratio. Friends, this ratio indicates the proportion of total assets financed by owners. It is simply calculated by dividing proprietor or shareholders' fund by total assets. This ratio establishes the relationship between shareholders' fund to total assets of the firm. The shareholders' fund are the sum of the equity share capital, preference share capital, and reserves and surplus. But friends, please note that out of this amount, accumulated losses should be deducted. On the other hand, the total assets mean total resources of the concern. Friends, equity ratio throws light on general financial position of an enterprise. This ratio is of particular importance to the creditors who can find the proportion of shareholders' fund in the total assets employed in the firm. Another point to note is a high ratio shows that there is safety for creditors of all types. Higher the ratio, the better it is for the concern. A low proprietary ratio indicates a greater risk to the creditors, since in the event of losses, a part of their money may be lost besides the loss to the proprietor of the business. Now friends, let's solve a practical question to make the concept of proprietary ratio more clear. Now from the data given, you have to calculate the proprietary ratio. Friends, we already learned in the last slide that proprietary ratio is calculated simply by dividing proprietor or shareholders' fund by total assets. So in this question, shareholders' fund will be calculated as equity share capital plus preference share capital plus reserves and surplus, which is 1 lakh plus 50,000 plus 25,000. Now friends, this adds to 1,75,000. Then total assets will be fixed assets plus current assets plus investments. Now the sum of this is 2,50,000. So friends, the proprietary ratio will be 1,75,000 divided by 2,50,000, which is 0.7, or we can simply say 70%. Now let's learn fixed assets to net worth ratio. Now friends, this ratio establishes the relationship between fixed assets and shareholders' funds. It is simply calculated by dividing fixed assets by shareholders' funds. The shareholder funds include equity share capital, preference share capital, reserves and surplus, including accumulated profits. However, please note that fictitious assets like accumulated deferred expenses should be deducted from the total of these items to shareholders' funds. Now friends, we already learned earlier that the shareholders' funds so calculated are also known as the net worth of the business. Now the fifth ratio in the category of solvency ratio is fixed assets to long-term funds ratio. Now friends, this ratio establishes the relationship between fixed assets and long-term funds and is simply calculated by dividing fixed assets by long-term funds. Finally, the last ratio in the category of solvency ratio is debt service or interest coverage ratio. Now friends, this ratio shows the number of times the earnings of the firms can cover the fixed interest liability of the firm. This ratio therefore is known as interest coverage or time interest earned ratio. So this ratio is simply calculated by dividing earnings before interest and tax, that is EBIT, by interest charges on the loan. Friends, hope you are clear with this category of ratios. Now let's move on to the last category, but very important category of ratios, that is profitability ratios. Friends, the main aim of any firm is to earn profit, which is necessary for survival and growth of the business firm. Now the profit is earned with the help of amount invested in the business. It is therefore necessary to know how much profit has been earned with the help of amount invested in the business. Now friends, this is possible only through profitability ratios. Profitability ratios measures the efficiency of management in the employment of business resources to earn profits. These ratios indicate the success and failure of a business firm for a particular period of time. Profitability ratios are in fact used by almost all the parties connected with the business. So a strong profitability position ensures common stockholders a higher dividend income and appreciation of stock price in the future. Now friends, creditors, financial institutions and preferred stockholders expect a prompt payment of interest and fixed dividend income only if the business has a good profitability position. Also note that management also needs higher profits to pay dividends and reinvest a portion in business to increase production capacity and strengthen the overall financial position of the company. Now friends, the profitability ratio of the firm can be measured by calculating various profitability ratios. Generally, there are two groups of profitability ratios that are calculated. First group is profitability in relation to sales. Then second group is profitability in relation to investment. Now, next we will learn both these groups in depth. Let us first see profitability in relation to sales. Under this, we will learn five ratios. First is gross profit margin or ratio. Second is net profit margin or ratio. Then third is operating profit margin or ratio. Then fourth is operating ratio. And lastly, fifth one is expenses ratio. Let us see each of these ratios in detail. Now first is gross profit margin. Now this ratio shows the relationship between gross profit and total net sales revenue. Now friends, it is a popular tool to evaluate the operational performance of a business. It is simply calculated by dividing gross profit by net sales. Now net sales or net revenue from operations equals total sales, and we subtract sales return and excise duty from total sales. Now gross profit equals revenue from operations minus cost of revenue from operations. Now friends, gross profit ratio shows the margin of profit. A high gross profit ratio is a great satisfaction to the management. It represents the low cost of the revenue from operations. Now higher the rate of gross profit, lower the cost of revenue from operations. Let us solve a practical example to understand this ratio better. The following information is available for the year 2018-19. Now calculate the gross profit ratio. Now friends, we already know that gross profit ratio is calculated by dividing gross profit by net sales. So our first task is to find gross profit and net sales. Now revenue from operations or net sales is calculated as cash revenue from operations plus credit revenue from operations, which is rupees 25,000 plus rupees 75,000, which gives rupees 1 lakh. Next, we have to find net purchases. Now, this equals cash purchases plus credit purchases minus return outwards, which is rupees 15,000 plus rupees 60,000 minus rupees 2,000, that is rupees 73,000. Now, finally, we find cost of revenue from operations, which will be purchases plus opening inventory minus closing inventory plus direct expenses. We can also write this as purchases plus decrease in inventory plus expenses plus direct expenses. Now purchases we have already calculated above, that is rupees 73,000. So when we substitute all the values, we get rupees 73,000 plus rupees 10,000 plus rupees 2,000 plus rupees 5,000, which is equal to rupees 90,000. Now friends, gross profit will be revenue from operations minus cost of revenue from operations, which is rupees 1 lakh minus rupees 90,000, that is rupees 10,000. Now friends, with all these figures, we can finally calculate gross profit ratio, that is gross profit divided by net revenue from operations multiplied by 100, that is 10,000 divided by rupees 1 lakh multiplied by 100. This gives 10%. Friends, hope you got the question and how we find different figures from the data given in the question. Next ratio is net profit margin or ratio. Now friends, this ratio measures the relationship between net profit and sales of a firm. It indicates management's efficiency in manufacturing, administrating, and selling the products. It is simply calculated by dividing net profit after taxes by sales. Now, net profit ratio determines the overall efficiency of the business. It indicates the extent to which management has been effective in reducing operational expenses. Now, higher the net profit ratio, better it is for the business. Friends, constant increase in this ratio year after year is a definite indication of the improving condition of the business. Let's again solve a practical example to understand the concept better. Now, in this question, you have to calculate the net profit ratio from the data given. Now, friends, you already know that the net profit ratio is calculated by dividing net profit after tax by sales. Now, net profit for this firm will be 40,000 minus 10,000 minus 10,000, that is rupees 20,000. Now, this is calculated by subtracting selling expenses and administrative expenses from gross profit. So, net profit margin will be 20,000 divided by 1 lakh multiplied by 100. This gives 20%. Next ratio is operating margin or ratio. Friends, this ratio establishes the relationship between total operating expenses and net sales. Or we can say that this ratio shows the relationship between the cost of goods sold plus other operating expenses and net sales. Now, the operating ratio is mainly calculated to ascertain the operational efficiency of the management in their business operations. So, let us see how this is calculated. Operating ratio is simply calculated by dividing operating expenses by net sales. Now, operating expenses include the cost of goods produced or sold, general and administrative expenses, selling and distributive expenses. Now, friends, this ratio is a test of operational efficiency with which the business is being carried out by the management. So, the operating ratio should be low enough to leave a position of sales to give a fair return to the investors. Also note that a low operating ratio means a high net profit ratio, that is more operating profit. Now, this ratio should be compared first with the company's previous year's ratios and second with the ratio of other companies in the same industry. So, an increase in this ratio should be investigated and brought to the attention of management. Another point to note is that the operating ratio varies from industry to industry. Let us solve another question to make the concept of operating ratio more clear. So, you are given the following information and you have to calculate gross profit ratio and operating ratio. Let us first calculate the gross profit ratio. So, gross profit will be revenue from operations minus cost of revenue from operations. This information is already given in the question. So, it will be rupees 3,40,000 minus rupees 1,20,000, which gives rupees 2,20,000. Now, gross profit ratio will be gross profit divided by revenue from operation multiplied by 100, which gives rupees 2,20,000 divided by rupees 3,40,000 multiplied by 100. On solving this, we get 64.71%. Now, let's find operating ratio. Now, friends, we already learned operating margin equals operating expenses divided by net sales multiplied by 100. So, operating expenses will be cost of revenue from operations plus selling expenses plus administrative expenses, which is rupees 1,20,000 plus 80,000 plus 40,000, which gives rupees 2,40,000. So, operating ratio will be rupees 2,40,000 divided by rupees 3,40,000 multiplied by 100. So, this gives 70.59%. Friends, hope the question is clear. Let us move ahead with the next ratio. Friends, though some of the expenses may be increasing and others may be declining, but to know the behavior of specific item of expenses, the ratio of each individual operating expenses to net sales should be calculated. Now, various types of expenses ratios that are calculated are, first is cost of goods sold ratio, which is COGS divided by net sales multiplied by 100. Then second is administrative expenses ratio, which is calculated simply by administrative expenses divided by net sales multiplied by 100. Lastly, we have selling and distribution expenses ratio, which is calculated by selling and distribution expenses divided by net sales multiplied by 100. So friends, in previous years, very few questions have been asked from this part, but still you should know how to calculate all these ratios, as you may not know when IIBF may put a question based on these ratios. Now friends, the last ratio in the list of profitability ratios with respect to sales is operating profit margin or ratio. This ratio establishes the relationship between operating profit and net sales. It is calculated by dividing net profit by sales. Now, as we learned earlier, operating profit equals net sales minus cost of goods sold minus administrative expenses and minus selling and distribution expenses. Now friends, operating ratio is computed to express the cost of operations excluding financial charges in relation to revenue from operations. Also note that a lower operating ratio is in fact a very healthy sign for any company. Now let us see the second set of profitability ratios. This is with respect to investments. These ratios are in fact very carefully monitored by investors in the company. Now friends, I personally invest in the stocks for the long term. So friends, I regularly monitor all these ratios of the companies that I have invested in. So profitability ratios in relation to investments are of four types. First is return on gross investment or gross capital employed. Second is return on net investment or net capital employed. Then third is return on shareholders investment or shareholders capital employed. And lastly, fourth one is return on equity shareholders investment or equity shareholder capital employed. Now let us learn each one of these ratios in detail. First one is return on capital employed. Now this ratio establishes the relationship between net profit and the gross capital employed. Friends, the term gross capital employed refers to the total investment made in the business. Now to calculate this, just divide earnings after tax by gross capital employed. Next ratio is return on net capital employed. Now this ratio is calculated by dividing earnings before interest and tax by net capital employed. Friends, the term net capital employed in the gross capital is the business minus current liabilities. Thus, this ratio represents the long-term funds supplied by creditors and owners of the firm. Next ratio is return on share capital employed. This ratio establishes the relationship between earnings after taxes and the shareholder investment in the business. Friends, this ratio reveals how profitably the owner's funds have been utilized by the firm. It is simply calculated by dividing earnings after tax by shareholders' capital employed. Next ratio is return on equity share capital employed. Friends, equity shareholders are entitled to all the profits remaining after all outside claims, including dividends on preference share capital, are paid in full. Now the earnings may be distributed to them or retained in the business. Now return on equity share capital investments or capital employed shows the relationship between earnings after tax and preference dividend and equity shareholder investment or capital employed or net worth. This ratio is simply calculated by dividing earnings after tax and preference dividend by equity shareholders capital employed. Now friends, apart from the ratios we learned till here, there are some other profitability ratios as well. Some of them are earnings per share, then dividend per share, then dividends payout ratio, also called payout ratio, then dividends and earnings yield, and lastly price to earnings ratio. Let us see each of these ratios in detail. Let us first discuss earnings per share. Now friends, earnings per share measures how many rupees of net income have been earned by each share of the common stock. It is calculated by dividing net income less preferred dividend by the number of shares of common stock outstanding during the period. This ratio measures the profit available to the equity shareholders on a per share basis. Friends, also note that the higher the EPS figure, the better it is. A higher EPS is a sign of higher earnings, strong financial position, and therefore a reliable company to invest money. Next is dividend per share. Friends, the dividend paid to the shareholders on a per share basis is nothing but dividend per share. Thus, dividend per share is the earnings distributed to the ordinary shareholders divided by the number of ordinary shares outstanding. Next ratio is dividends payout ratio, or simply payout ratio. Now friends, this ratio discloses what portion of the current earnings the company is paying to its stockholders in the form of dividend and what portion the company is plowing back in the business for growth in the future. It is computed by dividing dividend per share by earnings per share for a specific period. Friends, the payout ratio is an indicator of the amount of earnings that have been plowed back into the business. The lower the payout ratio, the higher will be the amount of earnings plowed back into the business and vice versa. Next is dividends and earnings yield. This ratio is particularly useful for those investors who are interested only in dividend incomes. This ratio is simply calculated by comparing the rate of dividend per share with the market value. Its formula can be put like this. So friends, if a company declares a dividend at 20% on its shares, each having a paid up value of Rs. 8 and the market price of Rs. 25, then the dividend yield ratio can be calculated as dividend per share divided by market value of an ordinary share. So dividend per share will be 20 divided by 100 multiplied by 8, which is Rs. 1.60. So dividend yield ratio will be simply 1.6 divided by 25 multiplied by 100, which is 6.4%. Now let us see another important ratio, that is price to earning ratios, or simply called PE ratio. This ratio shows how many times the annual earnings the present shareholders are willing to pay to get a share of the company. This ratio actually helps investors to know the effect of earnings per share on the market price of the share. This ratio, when calculated over several years, can be used in predicting the future price to earnings ratios and therefore future stock prices. Now friends, calculating future stock prices is out of scope of this lecture and also of JAB and CIB. Friends, practically, I use this ratio to predict the future price of any stock for any particular year. Now this ratio is simply calculated by dividing the market price of the share by earnings per share. For example, if the earnings per share of X Limited is Rs. 10 and the market price is Rs. 100, then the price to earning ratio will be 10, that is 100 divided by 10. Now friends, this ratio reflects investors' expectation about the growth in firm's earnings and reasonableness and validates the market price of its shares. Also note that PE ratio varies from industry to industry and company to company in the same industry depending upon investors' perception of their future. Finally, let us solve a practical example to understand the concept of all these ratios easily. So from the information given in this table, calculate earnings per share, book value per share, dividend per share, and price to earning ratio. So friends, let's start calculating each of these ratios. First is earnings per share, which is profit available for equity shareholders divided by number of equity shares. So from the given data, it is Rs. 1,75,000 divided by 70,000, which gives Rs. 2.50. Now second, we have to calculate book value per share, which is nothing but equity shareholders funds divided by number of equity shares. Now equity shareholders funds will be Rs. 7 lakh plus 1,75,000, which is Rs. 8,75,000. So book value per share will be Rs. 8,75,000 divided by 70,000, that is Rs. 12.50. Next, we have to calculate dividend payout ratio, which is nothing but dividend per share divided by earnings per share. So 1.50 divided by 2.50 gives 0.6. Lastly, we have to calculate price to earnings ratio, which is market price of a share divided by earnings per share. So this will be simply 13 divided by 2.5, which gives 5.20. So friends, hope the question is clear to you. Finally, with this numerical, I wind up this lecture. Hope you understood all the ratios. If you have any confusion in any ratio, then feel free to ask your query in the comment section. Lastly, friends, do check out our JIB and CIB resources. As we saw earlier, all the links are in description to this video, so do check out now. And if you still haven't subscribed this amazing channel, then do hit like as well as subscribe button. By doing this, you will never miss any important video which we are going to launch before exams. This channel is not just about JIB, CIB and bank promotion exams, but we cover many interesting banking issues and topics. So thank you and all the best for your exams.